The Supreme Court has been playing Hamlet in the matter of capital punishment. At this moment, it seems to be saying that capital punishment is permissible, but executions are not. In 1972, the court ruled 5-4 that existing capital punishment statutes were cruel and unusual. The states, 35 of them, responded almost instantly by enacting different laws that appeared to meet the court's objections. And then, in July of 1976, the court ruled 7-2 that of the five states whose statutes were under review, three of them, Georgia, Florida, and Texas, were okay, two of them, Louisiana and North Carolina, were not. Meanwhile, in Utah, the convicted murderer, Gary Gilmore, is experiencing his only failure as a killer. He cannot contrive to kill himself or get himself killed. The Supreme Court is thinking that one over. Our two guests have pronounced views on the subject of capital punishment. Professor Ernest Vandenhaag is well known to viewers of this program as the author of Punishing Criminals, among other things, a book that has received high critical acclaim, and a book that endorses capital punishment for reasons we shall presently be familiar with. And Professor Vandenhaag teaches social philosophy, psychology, and sociology at New York University and at the New School for Social Research. Opposed to capital punishment is Professor Donald Shapiro, a dean of the New York Law School and a professor there. Mr. Shapiro's experiences in law, education, and medicine and publishing occupy acres of space in Who's Who. I'd like to begin by asking a relatively simple question. Does the work of Professor Ehrlich add up to anything, Mr. Shapiro?
No, the work of Professor Ehrlich, by the end, when he said in these conclusions, he said there's nothing in this empirical evidence that he's done. In fact, I can even quote him, I think. Professor Ehrlich says, these observations do not imply that the empirical investigation has proved the existence of the deterrent or preventive effect of capital punishment. He further concludes that these results do not imply that capital punishment is necessarily a desirable form of punishment. In other words, he says there's no scientific conclusions that can be drawn from his work.
Well, but my understanding was that he established a correlation roughly as follows, that for every person you didn't execute who was convicted as a murderer, maybe as many as 6 or 7 people would die.
He says that earlier in the article, but then at the end of the article, he makes these statements which I just quoted, that you cannot take that conclusion based on his scientific observation.
In other words, it's just a hypothesis, isn't it?
Just a hypothesis, which he says is not proven by his own work.
Mr. Vandenhaag, you wrote for the Wall Street Journal, as did Professor Shapiro, and I think came to different conclusions on that point, did you?
Yes, I did.
I don't want to dwell too long on deterrent, but I'm interested in getting it over with.
Well, obviously, Professor Ehrlich wouldn't have written his article if he didn't think that they prove some conclusion. The conclusion that he generally drew was that each execution, it was a period 1933 to 1969, would have spared us between 7 and 8 additional murders. And then, being a very careful scholar, he goes on to say that this is not a definitive and conclusive proof, and there are all kinds of qualifications. So that the conclusion I drew, unlike Professor Shapiro, is that what Ehrlich has really shown is that there's a very high risk that if we fail to execute a convicted murderer, if we did between 1933 to 1969, between 7 and 8 additional murders would be committed that otherwise would have been deterred.
I don't think that even Professor Vandenhaag would suggest on a mere speculation in an article that we should execute 7 or 8 people if that is the only reason for it. I think whether professors only write articles when they're firmly convinced what they say is the absolute truth, I think we'd have a lot less publishing in the world. They write articles for many reasons, as we all know.
Probably a lot less murders, too.
Yes, maybe by students. But Professor Ehrlich himself, and I quote an authority no less than Professor Vandenhaag, based on his own observation and his own investigation, is against capital punishment because he thinks it's morally undefensible.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, wait, there are two slight misstatements, undoubtedly both unwitting. What I'm suggesting is not that seven or eight people be killed to spare one man, but the other way around, that one convicted murderer be executed to spare seven to eight victims of future murderers. Now, I agree that one is certain, we execute the convicted murderer, the other is a risk. But I'm not willing to take the risk of losing between seven and eight innocent victims merely for the sake of sparing the life of a convicted murderer. The second point is that, as I did tell you, Professor Ehrlich is opposed to the death penalty, but not on the basis of any observation, but simply on the basis that he personally feels morally opposed to it. As you know, one's moral opposition is not based on observation, but on feelings.
Well, on the whole business of deterrent, Mr. Shapiro, you mentioned in your article that it was one of the common jibes of the 18th century that, I think you quoted Sam Johnson specifically, that although in those days they would hang children for the crime of stealing a loaf of bread, nevertheless at these great public executions, they would turn out to be field days for pickpockets, and that this was the most melodramatic example that you could think of the non-deterrent aspect of capital punishment.
Right.
Is that correct?
You're right, indeed. Boswell, quoting Dr. Johnson, points out it was the hanging of pickpockets which encouraged more pickpocketing at the execution of pickpockets.
How do you account for that?
Well, because I don't think that capital punishment is a deterrent. What I think is a deterrent...
It would deter you, wouldn't it? I mean, if you wanted to pickpocket, wouldn't you think twice about it if you saw a guy being hanged for doing exactly that?
Of going to jail would deter me. I think that what deters people is the certainty and swiftness of punishment rather than whether it's capital or not.
Mm-hmm. Well, but certainly you would rather go to jail, say, for 30 days than be hanged, wouldn't you?
Well, the dean of law school goes to jail for 30 days. I don't know whether I'd... You know, there's certain social disgraces depending on each person. I think deterrent becomes a very personal thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think that Mr. Gilmore's case, who Dr. Van der Haag referred to, is a man who really is seeking death. Death is a preventive to Mr. Gilmore. It certainly doesn't appear so.
Mm-hmm.
Some arguments were made by psychologists that certain people seek the death penalty.
Well, Mr. Gilmore is famous precisely because of his singularity. If everybody in the death house was seeking death, nobody would have noticed who Ms. Gilmore was.
No, in other case, there have been other cases where murderers who have been sentenced to death have welcomed death.
Mm-hmm.
It's not unusual. Mr. Gilmore...
Well, I know of two, and there are between 400 and 600 people in the death houses now.
Well...
So it's at least that unusual.
Yeah, it's not common that people seek death.
May I point out that murderers are the people who have not been deterred. So this discussion is a little bit irrelevant. I never would maintain that everybody is deterred. But those who have murdered obviously have not been deterred. The second point I would like to make about Johnson is that Dr. Johnson made a mistake, which does not justify Professor Shapiro to make the same mistake. You see, the deterrent effect of the death penalty, including hanging a pickpocket, does not mean that the crime will be eliminated. It means merely that the rate at which it is committed is diminished. Now, if Dr. Johnson had shown that in two equally sized crowds, the one in which the pickpocket was hanged showed no less activity by pickpockets than the other, he might have shown something. Even there, I'm not convinced. Because you see, a professional pickpocket knew at the time that he would be hanged. So we did not expect him to be deterred. What we really mean by deterrence is that we want to deter new entrants into the profession. Those who are already entering the profession knowing that they run a risk of hanging are not likely to be surprised seeing someone being hanged and are not likely to be deterred by it. What we do hope to do by hanging or whatever the execution is to deter those not already committed to their course of action. That is, we make the course of action so costly that we will decrease the number of new entrants. And that is generally true for all punishments. And when we discuss the death penalty, it seems to me that what we are really discussing is whether the additional deterrent value that it has is sufficient to justify it. And that's a different discussion where I think the burden of proof is on Dean Shapiro. He would have to prove why suddenly when normally the more severe the penalty, the more the deterrent force. Obviously, a $5 fine would not prevent people, deter people from rape as much as 5 years in prison. And 10 years in prison might deter them more than five. Why that should suddenly stop at the death penalty, why it should not effectively add to deterrence, has always puzzled me.
Well, Professor Sellum has done a study, and the study, I think, conclusively proves that in states which have the death penalty, and adjoining states with almost the identical composition, which do not have the death penalty, there is really no difference in the murder rate.
Right, but the only trouble with his study is it was a study of laws. He did not study execution rates, which we all agree by now is the only thing that matters.
No,
whereas Ehrlich, for instance, studied execution rates.
He didn't study
is the law prescribing the death penalty, but are people actually executed?
No, I don't think, because I don't think most people even know when someone is executed or not. They hear about the trial. I mean, unless you're arguing again for public hangings, and that would be the element deterrent, I guess. Because then people would know when the execution took place, instead of sneaking away as the state does now, in private.
As you certainly have noticed, it is well known that Gary Goldmore and so many other people are about to be executed, and I'm sure no execution in the United States would ever be hidden.
Well, in the past, there have been many, many executions of which we have not been aware of.
Well, in 1953, there were 200, for instance.
Right, exactly.
Now, if there are 200, that means four a week. Now, they're not each going to get a lot of attention.
Yes, but people will know that murderers are being executed.
The fact is that people will know that just as people have car accidents every day, so also are they being executed.
Yes, but Bill, before when the Sellum study occurred, people were being executed. He proved that in states which had capital punishment and which were executing people, in adjoining states which had capital punishment and were executing people, that the rate of crime, the rate of murder, or the crimes which capital punishment was put out, was not appreciably different. That the fact, the death penalty itself did not create a greater deterring effect. And I agree with Ernst that the important thing is deterring other people from coming into the stream of crime. Now, Brandeis once said that the advantages of having states is where we have social laboratories. In this country, for many, many years, we've had certain states with death penalties and certain states without death penalties. And there's been no appreciable difference in deterrence. Now, there has been shown an appreciable rate of deterrence if there is not assuredness and swiftness of punishment for crime. If people think they can get away with things, I think that gets back to the Johnson example. If you have lax law enforcement, if most people are not caught, or if things don't seem to occur for years and years. Here, I would be more severe than Ernst. I think people who are convicted of crime, and for this I refer to the English example, where there is very quick trials and there are not lengthy, prolonged appeals, I think there should be a sureness and swiftness. I think this will act as the deterrent. I believe in the deterrent of punishment, but I don't think that capital punishment adds anything to the deterrent.
Well, that's halfway reasonable, but you ascribe a mildness to me that is wholly alien to me. You are not more
that
severe
I agree,
than
Ernst.
You are not more severe than I am. I agree with you fully on that. But on the point that you made before, in the states which Sellum investigated, first, in some of these states there were hardly any executions. And he did not, take into consideration the rate of execution as Ehrlich did. Secondly, he failed to take into consideration, as Ehrlich did, all kinds of other variables that influence the rate at which capital crimes are committed. You see, as you and I both know, punishment and the threat of punishment is not the only thing that determines the rate at which a crime will be committed.
Indeed, in most murders, there are all kinds of things.
For instance, the age composition of the population. Most murders are committed by young people. The sex composition, most murders are committed by males. All kinds of economic factors and so on. Sellum disregarded all of that, which leads me to say that his statistics are not very valuable, whereas Ehrlich took them into very careful consideration, which is why I call his investigation far more sophisticated, far more weighty, and far more conclusive, if any such investigation can be, than Sellum's was.
Well, I disagree with you there. In fact, it's a whole issue of the Yale Law Review, which has been basically written to refute Ehrlich.
And has not succeeded.
Ernst, I don't think there's anyone alive who could have written a report to
Let me move on and ask you this, Mr. Shapiro. If it were established that it served as a deterrent, not a total deterrent, because nothing of it does, but a deterrent to the extent of validating the hypothetical figures of Professor Ehrlich. Would you then change your mind, or would you have the same conclusion as Professor Ehrlich, that even then he would not
condone? I'd have the same conclusion as Professor Ehrlich, though I'd be a lot less convinced. Mm-hmm. Because I think that it's a price we pay in society for the moral debasement of society when the state engages in the killing business. Mm-hmm. And you're talking about if we had 200 executions, so maybe we'd have saved 1,600 people. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's worth it for society to engage in the killing business. I don't think it's worth it because of the way our courts operate. Ernst obviously believes more in the infallibility of the courts than I do, because death is very final, and courts do make mistakes. I mean, there are so many examples now. I know there are studies by someone who had a crystal ball who determined that only X percentage of these people really could have been innocent. But that's very difficult to determine, because many people that have appeared to me to be very guilty have later turned out to be innocent. And I know from your own experiences and your own work, people who may very well seem to be innocent may very well turn out later to be guilty. It's very difficult. Justice is a very imprecise thing, and death makes it very final, where at least the possibility of correcting the errors in our judicial system.
Well, if somebody is put away for 30 days, mm-hmm. that also is irreversible.
Yes.
Now, he comes up alive. That's true, at the end of the 30 days.
And the state can pay him for the 30 days, and in most states he could sue for payment for those 30 days. He's unjustly imprisoned.
Well, can't get the 30 days back, though, can he?
No. Or he can get his money.
Yeah, presumably the estate can also sue in the event of an improper execution. Isn't that correct?
You mean that
the estate.
The deceased estate could sue the state.
That's right.
Yeah.
Now, as I understand it, you say
it would make the children and wife maybe happy. Mm-hmm. Hardly the victim.
Well, it would make them comfortable. That's right. But we are taking a position in the light of an assumption that there are going to be 1,600 innocent victims under your dispensation, right?
Yes.
So 1,600 innocent victims are as dead as the 200. Mm-hmm. But in all cases, they are innocent. Whereas in the case of the 200, you're talking about a hypothetical 1-2%. Turn out to be innocent.
I would say, I just don't know what that figure is. Mm-hmm.
But in any case, it's less than 100%.
Oh, absolutely.
Right, so
but remember, I said something else. That wasn't the only reason I gave. The other reason was the moral debasement of society, mm-hmm. because you have the state engaged in killing. Mm-hmm. And I think for the state to be engaged in systematic killing morally debases our society and morally debases our legal system.
Well, aren't you mixing up an intrinsic act and a purely procedural act? It is not engaged in killing. It is engaged in seeing to it that somebody die. Now that's not a frivolous philosophical distinction, is it?
Well, the agent who does the killing mm-hmm. is an agent of the state.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to say that an executioner is less moral than you or I. It's a business that he is an agent of the state. Mm-hmm. He is carrying out the orders of the state. Mm-hmm. Therefore, any time an execution is carried out, it is carried out by us, who comprise the state.
Yes, but we are propelling a person into a different estate, the estate of deadness, if you like. This is the distinction to which philosophers pay a great deal of attention.
Right.
We are not killing in the sense of desiring the experience of killing. We are simply desiring the effect. Now, this is important.
Notice I didn't say murder. I mm-hmm. said killing.
Yeah.
I don't see the difference in killing. I know the philosophic arguments. There's not murder. No. I never claimed the state was engaged in legalizing.
It's an execution.
It's an execution, yeah. Which is a killing.
Ms. Van Hout.
I think we should take the responsibility for that. We wish to proclaim the sacredness and the inviolability of human life. And there is no way in which the law can proclaim that other than saying, he who violates what is inviolable will himself suffer the taking of his own life.
You sound like the Old Testament.
Yes,
I do indeed.
And he's written a brilliant book pointing that out.
Indeed, and I agree with the Old Testament, also with the new one. They don't need my endorsement, but still.
But it'll probably cost you a few readings.
Let me point out that it is a moral responsibility.
Yes.
But I think a society should not shrink from that moral responsibility. Now, when you say, Don, that somehow it is demoralizes or is bad for society, you have not offered a shred of proof, have you, that it is bad. And I think one could just offer as much proof for saying that failing to execute the murderer demoralizes society. It makes it feel that life is cheap, that you can get away with killing someone else, being slightly inconvenienced for a few years, which is all that happens in New York usually, and so on.
Ernst, that's unfair. You know that I'm not in favor of short sentences for murder or serious crime.
But that's what happens. You agree,
well,
don't you?
I think, no, some states yes and some states
in
no.
In New York, that's what happens.
Well, I
on the average, 3 years.
I have, for first degree murder?
Yes.
I don't think that's quite right. But what I'm saying is, I don't think it's something we should argue about.
Don, excuse me, let's just clarify this. When you say it's not right for first degree murder, it is, you're quite right, statistically. But what happens is that in many first degree murders.
Well, it's the only way I know how to be right.
What happens is that in many first degree murders, the murderer is allowed to plead guilty to second or third degree and get 3 years. In my opinion, he remains a first degree murderer.
Well, Ernst, you just touched on another argument against your basic thesis. Prosecutors, many times, when they have to try to convince a jury to give the death penalty, will settle for a second or a third degree plea in order that they can easier get even and more easily get a conviction. There have been all sorts of studies on this. Now, I think what you do is you basically have prosecutors lessening the sentence because they realize that their case is not that appealing, that they're going to get a capital conviction.
Well, there are all kinds of reasons, and forgive me, the plea bargaining, which allowed murderers to plead second and third degree, occurred when New York State did not have a valid death penalty law. So I don't think that was the reason. But let's go on to something else. This is a little too technical, perhaps.
Well, I don't think it's too technical, but we want to make certain of its relevance. I understand Mr. Van Hark to be saying the only way that you can communicate the extent to which a society believes in human life is by visiting the ultimate sanction on those who take it. And the ultimate sanction is the taking of their life. But he asked you a question to which you haven't yet had a chance to reply. What data do you have for suggesting that it is damaging to a society to execute those of its criminals found guilty of murder?
Well, there have been studies done by various groups, which there is no empirical study done to prove either point. But there have been studies done to show that there's more coarseness in society when the state itself engages in immoral activities, and killing to me is an immoral activity, that how can the state be the great teacher?
How is the coarseness shown?
Well, taking a life is a coarseness.
Well, do you mean the murder rate increases when the death penalty is imposed? Do you know of any study that shows that?
Yes. The American Civil Liberties Union, in their book on the death penalty, claims that there is a study that shows that states which have a death penalty had a higher murder rate than before. Now, whether I believe in the study or not, I'm not going to sit here and debate it.
Well, as a matter of fact, Ernest, it is true that the murder rate went down in the United States after 1933.
Right.
And only recently, in the last 3 or 4 years, went back and exceeded the 1933 level.
Yeah, but you see, there are many
even
determinants.
Even though the population has gone up.
Yeah. But there are many determinants of the murder rate. You see, I never would maintain, nor would Don, that the only thing that determines the murder rate is the kind of penalty given. There are many determinants, including, for instance, it went up lately, obviously, in great part, because there are more young people in the population. Murder is a young man's game, so the rate will go up when there are more young males in the population. There are all kinds of things like that. But if you, I must say, there's no serious evidence that the murder rate increases because the death penalty is imposed, and I don't think you seriously will believe that, Don, so let's go on to something else.
Well, I seriously believe there's
no
study.
Stop telling us to go on to something else, will you? I'm in charge of where we go on.
He not only makes these arguments against you, he acts as moderator at the same time. As I said, he is one of the greatest legal minds since Torquemada.
By the way, go ahead.
Well, all right. The argument that the Supreme Court is now hung up on is involving Gilmore. You would analyze how, Mr. Shapiro? And are you in sympathy with it? why has the scheduled execution of Gilmore, in which he acquiesces, been interrupted by the court? Well, and are you sympathetic with that interruption?
I'm not. You know, the whole Gilmore case, I have very little sympathy for, because here you have a murderer, a thug, who I think that his wishes or his desires do not really concern me. The actions of the state of Utah concern me. You know, I'm awful. I'm just amazed that people are so concerned, people in favor of capital punishment said, good God, let the poor man get the death he wants. Well, I have no sympathy for that. I'd like to not let people who commit murder get what they want. I think it's more important what the state decrees in the best interest of all the inhabitants of the state.
Well, would you not extend that to the point of killing those prisoners who didn't want to be killed?
No.
You just would not kill those who did want to be killed? To sort of frustrate them?
Cruel and unusual punishment. No. What I'm saying is that the state has decreed that it will not take a life.
Yeah.
If the state decrees this, then I think that the desire of an inmate that his life be taken, I think is completely immaterial to the state's determination. Now, even in Utah, where the state has determined that the life should be taken, I think that's a determination by the state. I think there's every right to fight that determination on the legalities of the Utah law and so forth. But I don't see any reason why Gilmore's wishes should bear one way or the other.
Well, and therefore you believe that the intercession of the Supreme Court is entirely proper.
Right.
And what grounds did they actually give for interceding?
Well, the law of Utah, of course.
Excuse me, I think the ground given, if they intercede at all, that his mother is pretending that he's incompetent. She would have no standing if the murderer is an adult, except by saying that he's incompetent. And apparently she is saying he's incompetent because he wants something that she doesn't approve of, in which case most of us would be incompetent, since most of us want things that our mothers do not approve of. I think that's what it amounts to, but you know...
That's amazing, Ernst. You're changing the whole case into one of mother love.
What really amazes me about you is that you're so much opposed to civil liberties, which is news. you see, I would think that anyone, a convict or a non-convict, a murderer or a non-murderer, should have the choice of ending his life if he's a competent person. If he's not competent, it's a different matter. But if he's competent and decides that he prefers to die rather than to spend the rest of his life in prison, that seems to me a reasonable choice. You may not agree with it. Most convicts don't, but some convicts do. Now, you said before that convicts...
We have to pause for just 1 second. You were saying, Ms. Van Hogg.
No, I think Don can answer.
I think there's a big difference. I think there's one thing about Gilmore killing himself. It's another thing, the state killing Gilmore. I don't think that a convict should have the right, I don't think that's a civil liberty, to say to the state, you kill me because I want to be dead.
No, but because you convicted me and gave me that punishment, so please carry out what you said you would.
Well, again, you're just begging the issue. The issue is whether we should have capital punishment, whether the state should kill.
The state of Utah has capital punishment.
Right.
So when Gilmore addresses the state of Utah, he addresses a state that has given him...
as you pointed out, by the mother, challenging the law under which this is being carried out.
But I don't think it is a sufficient reason to say a man must be incompetent because his mother disagrees with him.
Well, that's what the court will decide.
Yeah, but it seems to me absurd that the court even has to decide that.
Well, the whole law of Utah... the law of Utah itself has not been found to come within these new guidelines one way or the other.
That's news to me.
Well, it was Utah one of the cases that were decided?
No, it was not one of the five states.
Of course not.
But the Utah law is not dissimilar from the Texan law.
No.
It was passed.
No, but if Gilmore did not want to die, mm-hmm. Gilmore obviously could take an appeal challenging the Utah law, mm-hmm. and the court could or could not hear it. Now, the mother is simply stepping into Gilmore's shoes and taking that appeal on the Utah law. The Utah law was not passed on.
You mean your mother has that right? In your opinion, mothers should have the right to step in their sons' shoes and do what the sons don't want to do?
No, not
these
even,
sons
not even,
are
not
competent persons?
No, not even Jewish mothers. I'd say that the right here is based on whether there's competency or not. And I must say that Mr. Gilmore hasn't exactly acted as the most competent individual. Do you think so during the last few weeks?
Yes. Frankly, he was perfectly rational. In his reasoning, he simply, unlike you, prefers death to life in prison. Let me point out that my friend Jacques Berzon, who's a very competent person, in one of his books pointed out that he feels life in prison is far more cruel than execution. Whether you agree with him or not, the mere fact that you don't agree doesn't make him incompetent.
Unless you keep arguing in my favor that if there's a deterrent effect, life imprisonment without parole would be a much more effective deterrent.
No, I didn't say that. For some people it would. For most people, death is obviously far more deterrent, in my opinion. But the fact is that for Mr. Gilmore, death is easier, he feels, than life imprisonment. Since he hasn't been deterred in any case, we don't have to worry about that. For most people, the fear of death outranks, I think, all other fears.
And the only support you have for that, of course, is Ehrlich's study on rate of executions.
No, there are quite a number of other studies, which I haven't mentioned because we don't want to get involved into lots of quotations, but it's not the only study.
Well, accepting the fact that there are no empirical studies that either establish the coarsening effect of executions on the body politic or establish or confute the notion of capital punishment as a deterrent. How do you handle the argument of Chief Justice, or rather Associate Justice Rehnquist? He said in dissenting in 1972, how can government by the elected representatives of the people coexist with the power of the federal judiciary, whose members are constitutionally insulated from responsiveness to the popular will, to declare invalid laws duly enacted by the popular branches of government? Isn't he raising a very serious question that if we don't even have a factual basis for supporting our conclusions, what gives us the authority to intervene in a state brought it by its own people in a self-governing society?
That was decided
acting
Madison,
as they want.
That was decided in Madison versus Marburg.
Oh,
and also
it
was decided in McCulloch versus Maryland, in which the Supreme Court did say it had the right of judicial review and did have the right to review states.
On constitutional matters.
I would like to assume that a sitting associate justice has heard of Marshall versus Madison, Madison versus Marbury, and distinguishes between what was done there and what was recently been done by this particular court.
Eight of his brethren didn't agree with him. I think no one concurred with him in that opinion.
No, that was, you got the wrong one, that was 5-4.
No, but I think that he wrote a concurring opinion, didn't he?
Well, Justice Powell agreed with him. He said, nothing short of an amendment of the United States Constitution seems to be able to reverse the court's judgment. Meanwhile, all flexibility is foreclosed.
I know, but I think these were separate dissenting opinions.
Oh, yeah, but they all like to say the things their own way. But they dissented, that is to say, the notion that the deconstitutionalization of the capital of capital punishment is implicit in the Constitution is to begin with beggared by the fact that one of our Bills of Rights specifies that the taking of life, liberty, or property shall not be done without due process. Presumably, it may be done with due process, right? Therefore, it was envisioned that life was something that could be taken by the state.
But if you look upon law as a social adjustment to social needs, and the Constitution is read in the terms of today, and not in the terms of the days when it was written, I agree with you. At the time it was written, I do not agree with the arguments that capital punishment was banned by the Constitution. But I think if you look at the Constitution today and how we've interpreted that Constitution, many activities which would not have been banned at that time have since been banned or changed or modified by the action of the Supreme Court.
Well, so far today, you haven't said a single thing that points to the unconstitutionality of capital punishment, have you? But you nevertheless think there is something unconstitutional. None of the arguments that you've used in the last 35 minutes
I haven't addressed myself at all to the unconstitutionality.
Okay, now, do you think it's unconstitutional?
Do I think it's unconstitutional?
Yeah.
Yes.
Why?
I think it's unconstitutional reading the Constitution in light of today's morality and today's actions and the prior decisions of the Supreme Court, that it's It's a cruel and unusual punishment.
But today's
no, and I'd like to, if I just finish one thing, because I'd like to very heavily rely on Douglas's concurring opinion in the first case, in which he pointed out that the way capital punishment has been used in this country, there's been a history of an inequality of the use of capital punishment against the poor, against the black, against the speakers for unpopular causes. And I think that this whole theme is re-echoed in the dissenting opinion in the new decision by Justice Marshall.
Now, may I say something about it? First of all, I think, Don, and you can contradict me if I'm wrong, you would be against capital punishment in Sweden.
Absolutely.
And in Sweden, there are no minorities and so on of the kind that you feel are discriminated against. So your major reason has nothing much to do with discrimination. Your major reason is that you're against capital punishment. Furthermore, if you are opposed to discrimination, you should be opposed to the way that penalty is applied, not to the penalty. For the penalty does not inherently discriminate. Now, thirdly, to your constitutional point, it seems to me that indeed it is possible that something that 100 years ago or 200 years ago was not regarded as cruel and unusual, today will be so regarded. We have political institutions in which people can express their changed view and avoid or repeal laws that they regard as cruel and unusual.
In fact, they
changed
it in the last 10 years.
We have not entrusted that to the judges.
In fact, they changed it in the last 10 years.
Right.
Justice Brennan changed his position on capital punishment because he felt that one of the grounds on which he reached his original conclusion had changed, namely that whereas 65% of the American people used to oppose capital punishment, now 65% are demanding it.
And that's based on a popular opinion poll. And if President Ford believed those popular opinion polls last summer, we wouldn't have had the close election that we had now. I don't put a great deal of stock in those polls because there's one thing to ask in the abstract. There's another thing to ask in a particular case.
But how about votes? Why don't you let people vote on it as they do indeed by electing their representatives?
In fact, they have been plebiscites on the subject.
Yes, of course, they've been plebiscites.
But people do express their views. Now, what you seem to say is that it is for the court to find whether something is repugnant morally and not for people. And that seems to me really contradictory to everything I understand the Constitution to mean.
In fact, I think it's an impeachable offense.
Or an undeanable offense. But I think that I do think that Justice Marshall's dissenting opinion, and there's no sense going into in great detail, and I think Justice Douglas' concurring opinion in the first case states the argument that it's about as well as you can for the unconstitutionality of capital punishment.
As well as you can, yes, but not well enough.
And I think the felonious argument can be stated as well as possible by Ernest in his book. But I'm against capital punishment, not because...
Felonious or fallacious?
Fallacious, I'm sorry,
yeah.
I'm sorry.
I was wondering whether
it was a Freudian slip, obviously, in this case. I was probably more right the first time than the second. But I think the important matter is not whether capital punishment is constitutional or unconstitutional. I think the important matter is, should we or should we not have it in our society? And we have states which have not had it, and we have states which have it. And I think it's an easy answer to our rising crime problem, capital punishment. To me, it's a retreat to mob psychology. It's to reinforce the mob psychology that if you kill someone, oh boy, this will cut down crime. This is not an easy answer. The whole area of crime is much more complex, and it's going to require a lot more of our resources and a lot more of our judicial system's attention.
Well, we're not doing very much about it.
Lots
of people are getting killed in increasing numbers.
That's right.
The overwhelming majority of the American people desire a return to capital punishment. Any number of safeguards have been elaborated to prevent the killing of innocent people. What I want to know is there any other point at which you're going to interfere with self-government, or is this the only one in which you're willing to override the majority of the American people?
I'm willing to interfere with self-government anytime I think the Bill of Rights is violated. Because I think that, as Holmes once said, the will of the majority many times becomes a tyranny of the majority. And I think that the rights of the minority, and no one is more of a minority, as Ernst referred to me as a defender of murderers, no one is more of a minority than someone who is a murderer or someone who has broken the law. I think they have certain rights, And I think society has certain rights.
In New York, they'll probably become a majority if the graph continues in the current direction.
don't you think that they have a right to be defended by able counsel such as you, to be tried fairly and so on, but that it is up to the population as a whole to decide what the penalty for murder should be, and that it is not up to judges who apply the law to make the law and say, we decide that this penalty is not a good penalty, so the law made by the state will be discarded because we have just found something in the Constitution that nobody else could find there, namely that says that the judges have a right to disregard the wishes of the population, even when these wishes are well within the framework of what is permitted by the Constitution.
Loeb and Leopold, I think, are an ideal example of two people who, if they would not have been ably represented, they were poor.
What?
Well, they were very ably represented. They've gotten capital punishment, otherwise.
You say they were poor?
No, if they were poor.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you're ruining my argument, though.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
No, it's because they were rich and they could afford a Clarence Darrow.
Well,
that they escaped capital punishment.
We had a guy here recently called Harry Reams.
Yes.
And he had a very bright lawyer, full professor of law at Harvard Law School, and he only makes $100 for his porn flicks.
So it isn't just rich people.
That's
a little unfair. There was a huge fundraising group of activities with many prominent stars appearing to
buy
the legal fund.
There wasn't in behalf of Hurricane Carter also.
Yes.
So are you really saying that first-class defenses are not available to most poor people,
yes.
To most murderers, poor murderers? You mean you wouldn't represent a poor murderer for nothing if you were asked to?
I don't think I'd be a first-class defender of a poor murderer. I'm not a criminal lawyer.
You always told me the opposite, but at any rate, let's go.
That's the worst condemnation I've had today. But anyway...
he would persuade the judge not to permit him to be found guilty.
But I think...
Haven't you defended murderers?
No, I have not defended murderers.
That's what you had told me.
No. And, but
as
Ernest,
far as you know, you mean?
Yes, as far as I know. Nor have I associated with them, as far as I know. But I think that there is definitely an equation in American society between what you can afford and the type of justice you receive.
All right. I'm in favor of correcting that. But what has that to do
with the wave of your hand?
No, no. Let's correct that with everything you and I may agree on should be done. But why has that anything to do with either giving people prison sentences or death sentences or so on?
Because
some people are badly represented, is what you say, and that should be corrected. But what has that to do with the penalty?
Well, you get the Berlin versus Georgia case. The very first, this case was originally brought up in the inequality of its application of the death penalty. And that inequality of application has a lot to do with the inequality.
No, that's just one dissent.
Yeah.
That was the dissent of Justice Marshall.
Yes.
But the case against capital punishment has not, on the whole, rested on the basis of the inequality of application. That's just one tributary.
Well, it's one of the major thrusts of the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
I would like to argue it on different grounds, because quite frankly, I would like the people to outlaw it. And it has been outlawed in many, many states.
Well, and there I think we have a basis of agreement. If you and I could agree that each state should decide that for itself, I would advocate to the population of the state to vote for capital punishment, but I certainly would let you free to ask them to vote against it. But that means that the people decide and not the court.
But Dean Shapiro is a restorationist. He wants to bring democracy back to the United States. Mr. Ralph Cavanaugh is from the Yale Law School. Mr. Cavanaugh.
Mr. Vandenhaag, you began your argument with the observation that you felt it was justifiable to sacrifice one convicted murderer on the chance that you saved 7 to 8 people, and you based that equation on the work of Mr. Ehrlich. Now, I certainly don't wish to open the statistical debate. My question is, suppose Mr. Ehrlich's critics prevail and he loses his debate and the computer spins out next numbers the next time around. Would the elimination of the deterrence evidence convince you to change your position on capital punishment?
No, it would change my argument. I am in favor of executing convicted murderers as a moral matter. I also think that it will have the deterrent effect you just described. But if it didn't, and that would greatly surprise me, it would mean that there's some sort of point of diminishing returns after which penalties no longer add to the deterrence, which is possible, but nobody has been able to prove it so far. But even if that were the case, I would still say that by society must proclaim the sacredness of human life by threatening and inflicting the punishment of death to anyone who takes it wantonly. Moreover, let me make one other point. It is clear that this penalty is the only one that could restrain people who are already in prison for life and attack their prison mates or officers. It is clear that this penalty is the only one that could restrain a man who is already threatened with life imprisonment and sees the arresting officer approaching. He has no reason, unless there is a death penalty, for not killing the arresting officer. So I think for these reasons alone, I should remain in favor of the death penalty.
You know, Ernst, I must violently disagree with you on that. That's an argument often used, saying that if someone's already convicted and given life imprisonment, he'll become an unruly prisoner. There are other ways in prison. Solitary confinement is a very effective deterrent to many, many criminals.
At the present time, the federal prisons contain a man sentenced to life imprisonment who, since he is in prison, has managed to commit 3 more murders in 3 separate occasions. Now, unless we chain such a man in a way that was done 100 years ago and that you would not approve, nor would I do not think that you are going to give him immunity, in effect, by saying nothing further can happen to you except solitary confinement, which I don't think is that much of a punishment.
Oh, it really is, Ernst. I mean,
I have suffered it for 2 years. I didn't find it then.
Well, you had your own company, Ernst. I mean, very few people are that fortunate in solitary confinement.
Deborah Rohde is from the Yale Law School. Ms. Rohde?
Professor Black of the Yale Law School, in a book titled The Inevitability of Caprice and Mistake, advances the argument against capital punishment that choices at all stages of the criminal process which decide and distinguish between those who may live and those who will die are made without reference to intelligible standards, and that decisions about what offense to charge for, what to convict for, whether or not clemency is applicable, are made in highly discretionary fashion. And the argument basically is, and one which I hope Mr. Vandenhagen would respond to, is that irrespective of whether the sanction is effectual or not, is it defensible for a society which is committed to equal justice under law to tolerate the imposition of a sanction that will work out in an inequitable fashion?
Yeah. I think this is an argument that I think is really terribly wrong. It's perfectly true in the facts. A policeman has some discretion. There's a matter of chance whether the evidence will be available. A prosecutor has some discretion. A jury obviously has some discretion, and so on. This is unavoidable in any criminal process stuffed by human beings. Now, by calling it capricious, what Professor Black is doing is to say only if we have standards of justice enforced by, in effect, angels, not by human beings, without any possible arbitrary or discretionary field, only then will he tolerate the imposition of the death penalty, which is to say that the standard of perfection he wishes to obtain, which is clearly beyond any human possibility, is such that a priori the death penalty is excluded because it can never be applied by perfect beings such as angels. That seems an absurd argument to me, because obviously the framers of the Constitution knew that there would be human beings using discretion. Obviously, people know when they vote for the death penalty that there's some element of discretion. There is nothing perfect in human life. If that would restrain us from applying penalties, what you're really saying is we can't apply any penalties.
Well, but isn't the argument that imposition of other penalties which are inaccurately imposed can be corrected at a later date?
Are they?
Certainly.
You know of many cases where people sentenced to, say, 30 years in prison are released because the court made a mistake?
Certainly. On habeas petition, it happens all the time.
Habeas petitions happen all the time. People released happens not all the time, as you well know. There's no question that courts will make mistakes. But if that is a reason for not imposing penalties, we'll have to give up the process of criminal justice and leave it all to God. God will not make mistakes.
You know, that's amazing. You just said that there's no question that courts will make mistakes. Sure. And the next breath you say, let's have capital punishment.
Right.
An irreversible thing.
Right. Well, sometimes it is better to have irreversible mistakes than to have nothing.
But you wouldn't have, you're not going to have nothing. You're going to have life imprisonment without the possibility
nothing,
of parole.
Nothing sufficient.
You don't think life imprisonment without the possibility of parole is sufficient?
No.
Would you believe in public executions?
Not particularly.
I don't
because
believe
that
life imprisonment without the possibility of parole ever happens. Leopold Loeb, since you mentioned that, is a very good example.
Yes.
But even if it did happen.
Isn't the Leopold Loeb story sort of a wonderful story because he was rehabilitated, though the chances at the time would have been almost unheard of.
I don't deny that he was rehabilitated. I do deny that there was any intention at the time that they were spared execution that they should ever be released.
Oh, I agree with you. But we could pass a law to that effect.
I do want
to. I think we almost always do, and then something happens. In a sense, I don't believe in life in prison myself, because I think life without hope is intolerable. And under the circumstances, I am in favor of listening to applications for parole from people who've been in prison
for
a long
time. But
you
would believe. I agree with you, but you would say that there has to be a certain minimum number of years.
Sure.
I mean, and I'm against this California sort of revolving door of justice where I think first-degree murder is how many years before you come up, Ernest?
In Wisconsin, you can be released almost right away, and so you can in Florida.
Ernest overstates these things a little.
No, you can. In Wisconsin, there is no minimum.
I know, but Ernest, they rarely are released in the way out of the courtroom.
I said
like you
can.
Said.
I didn't say you will. I didn't overstate it at all. But not that, about your public execution business, this is a very common idea. You see, it seems to me that to do this would return us to the time in the past when executions were regarded as entertainments.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not in favor of having them entertainments. I think it is the knowledge that you will suffer death, not the actual attendance.
It's repugnant to you, isn't it?
Excuse me, I don't like to attend anyone dying, and I certainly think that anyone dying should be allowed privacy.
Indeed, you wouldn't pull the switch, would you? Or pull the trap?
I would not kill a cow either, though I like to eat beef.
Okay. But now, Ernest, you have agreed that, number one, that even if you weren't convinced on deterrent, that you would still believe in capital punishment. Number two, you have agreed that the courts make mistakes. Number three, you've agreed that morally you're sickened by the thought of public executions?
No, I'm only by the thought of it there being
entertainment. And entertainment, yes. You don't. You find it a coarseness to it. That's
not
what
a coarseness.
Sure.
No, I think it should be a man's death should not be exploited for purposes of entertainment. Any man's death, not even a criminal's.
Ernest, you seem to be agreeing with me.
Occasionally I do. You might be right once in a while. I don't know these things happen.
Mr. Seth Lerner from the University of Pennsylvania. Mr. Lerner.
Dean Shapiro,
yes.
What is the benefit for the state to pay for the upkeep, the food, the shelter for a convicted killer, murderer such as Gary Gilmore, than it is to have five volunteers to eliminate him from the society whose inviolable laws, as Mr. Van Hoen called them, he violated?
You mean they would save the cost of keeping
him
in
prison? No, not philosophically. Why is it better to pay for the public to pay for this, the state to pay for keeping him up, than it is to eliminate him?
Well, philosophically, I think it's better because the reasons I said. I think, number one, maybe not in Gilmore's case. In Gilmore's case, he very well may be ill, may be incompetent, and certainly I don't think society reinforces its moral image by putting to death an ill person. Number two, I think the fact that rehabilitation, which Bill referred to earlier, is a good goal for society at some length after it's sufficiently protected. You know, one of the things that could happen with most murderers is if you'd keep most murderers in prison beyond a certain age and then release them, and I think that Ernst would agree with me as far as the murder itself is concerned, but not as deterrence in society, most of them would rarely commit any sort of crime
again.
I'll
go a step further. I think some murderers are instantly rehabilitated by the murders they have committed.
Oh, yes,
if, for instance, you kill your wife, you probably just wanted to get rid of that particular wife. You're not a general wife killer. No. You might not even marry again. You're rehabilitated by having killed her. But the reason that we want to punish you is to protect other wives. Yeah. Whose husbands may have similar ideas.
Ernest, I think that's your idea, that you want to save them that way. But most murderers know they're a murderer. There's just a Vera study which came out last week, which again showed the very high incidence of knowledge, refuting an earlier study, which you had quoted in your book, about the lack of knowledge of the victim and the murderer. These crimes usually are entered into not with the thought of deterrence, especially murder, but out of passion. Now, and let's not be
Don,
a passion excuse.
You know as well as I do that crimes of passion are not usually punished with the death penalty. You know as well as
well,
I
no,
do
no,
that
I don't know
first
that.
Degree murder is usually the kind of felony murder where, say, a robber with a gun shoots a storekeeper and he never saw the storekeeper again before. This is normally if a man kills his wife or vice versa. I know of no case recently where the death penalty has been applied to such a crime of passion.
That's an unfair question, yes, ma'am. There's no question where the death penalty has been applied to anything since the Supreme Court ruling. But there have been cases of numerous doctors whose wives died under very strange circumstances who've been charged with first-degree murder.
But not a crime of passion. Forgive me, Dr. Friedgott, for instance, is accused in New Jersey not to have killed his wife because he was passionately opposed to her, but because he wanted to steal her money and marry somebody else.
You don't call that passion, Ernest.
No.
There's no blood
passion
in your veins.
Passion for money.
Well, passion for another woman, passion for money. Well, these are things.
In England, they've repeatedly executed people for crimes of passion.
Of course.
But let me, since we are, let me point out that in New York, 80% of all murderers used to know their victims, according to statistics. Since the death penalty has been abolished, that figure has been reduced to about 60%.
Now, the Vera Institute came out with a study last week in which they brought it back up again.
I saw the study, but it seems to me.
Did you get figures for this morning?
Well,
no?
let's
you have a ticker tape here, so you can see the latest study. But
what about this trend, Mr. Shapiro? That is a significant trend. As we only have a few seconds, is there a professionalization of murder since the end of the death penalty?
I don't think death penalty has anything to do with it. I think we have a depersonalization of society, which permeates all society. Where people just know each other less and less, that the old people are more mobile. And I do think that in a small town, there was more of a restraint. And I think you will have more stranger murder, as Ernest said, despite what almost any study says, whether you have the death penalty or you don't have it, as society becomes more and more depersonalized. And I think that's an entirely separate philosophical point.
Thank you, Dean Shapiro. Thank you, Professor Vandenhaag. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the panel. Thank you all.
Printed, bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. That's Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content and was funded in part by public television stations. Thank you.